How did you go from this to this and then to that? Well, through sheer engineering and prototyping like crazy. For those of you who may not know why anyone would want their keyboard to do this, let me do a quick recap. When typing on a normal keyboard, we rotate our wrist so the palms face downward. That creates a scissor-like movement between the ulna and the radius, pinching the tissues, nerves, and blood vessels on your wrist. To avoid that, you need to tilt your keyboard sideways, just like this, in opposite direction for its hand. That way, your wrist can rotate back to their natural position. The easiest way to achieve this is by bending your keyboard so it forms a little tent. If you do that, you get keyboards like the Peribor 413B, the Logitech K860, and their copycats. This keyboard already provides a significant improvement in comfort, but you're limited to just one tenting angle. Another way to do this is to split the keyboard in half and add some legs to prop its half laterally. Examples of this solution are the Kinesis Freestyle, the UHK60, and the Moonlander. Now you can better adjust the position of each half, but you are very limited to how high you can tend them. Higher tending angles allow your wrist to be closer to their natural position. This is not only more comfortable, but it also helps relieve pain if you suffer from tendinitis or carpal tunnel syndrome. However, for higher angles, most keyboards require a special attachment. These attachments are all similar and work very much like a book or a laptop stand. Two metal pieces on a hinge with a system to keep them in place. The problem with these attachments is that they are heavy and bulky, adding weight and height to the keyboard. Some even require a tool to set up. So, what would the ideal tenting solution look like? It should be light, strong, able to fold neatly into the body of the keyboard, easy to use, no tools required, and cover a wide range of angles. The first idea would be to build upon what has already been done. For example, here's the tenting solution of the Dygma Race. It uses two legs on hinges instead of two plates, with slots on the base for each angle. This makes the design sleeker, sturdier, and easier to set up. No tools are required. However, it doesn't meet all the requirements. It's heavy, it doesn't reach over 45 degrees, similar to other solutions, and most importantly, it doesn't fold into the body of the keyboard, so it adds height when not in use. For that, we need thinner legs that can fold into the body. But let's not forget that the solution needs to be sturdy on every angle. This next idea is based on a leg that slides through a rail and is secured by a clap. It's simple and allows for an infinite number of angles within its range, but that range is limited as the clamp is not really strong enough at low angles to keep the leg in place. However, its main issue is how difficult it is to set up. Since each side of the keyboard needs two legs, you need to match the angle on both legs perfectly, otherwise the keyboard would wobble. So what if instead of a sliding leg, we had a sliding rod? This way, the rod can slide into different preset positions, so both legs match, and a clamp holds it in place. This solution addresses the issues with low angles. It's now really firm. And the setup process, but introduces a new one. At higher angles, the rod is too perpendicular to the base, causing it to slide out of position. One solution to this problem would be to get rid of the clamp and instead add notches to the base. That way you can slide the rod into position and then attach its leg to the notch on the base. The problem with this solution is that on higher angles, the rod is not perpendicular enough to the notch on the base, so it jumps out of it. This means that with this design, we cannot reach the high angles that we want. What if the rod could have a different length depending on the angle? This solves the angle range problem. We have a long leg for high angles and a short leg for low angles, allowing for a perpendicular force against the base in most situations. However, there are two drawbacks. One is a bit trivial. It looks ugly, like Edward Scissorhands. The other one is more relevant. The UX is suboptimal. First, you need to find the right position for the rod on the leg. Then you need to deploy the correct claw and place it in the corresponding slot on the base. And you need to do that for both legs on both sides. It works, but it's not very elegant. What if we keep the idea of having two claws of different length, but eliminate the sliding part? And here it is. There are two rods, one for 5 to 20 degrees, and another one for 25 to 60 degrees. Each one is anchored on a fixed position on the aluminum leg, and it pivots on a hinge to reach the correct slot on the base. With this solution, the rods remain reasonably perpendicular to the base at all times, increasing stability. To improve the UX, there are markings on the rods and on the base. That way, you can easily assign the correct angle for both legs. There are also a couple of reverse tilting legs, which, in combination with the main legs, allow for 5 or 10 degrees reverse tilting. This allows you to rest your wrist at a neutral angle or slightly flexed, avoiding wrist extension. There are many other small details as well. The large aluminum legs feature a small notch that allows you to pull them out easily. These legs also feature a rounded silicone tip. The silicone prevents the keyboard from sliding, while the rounded shape is critical for the reverse tilting position. There are also small tie legs that account for the fact that the side of the keyboard is not straight. Without them, it would wobble. This is the system that you use today on the Dygma Defy and the Dygma Race 2. It's not perfect, but we're constantly working to improve it. Over the last couple of years, we've redesigned the hinges of the legs to prevent them from loosening with time. We also used stronger materials for added durability, and we've incorporated small details. On the Race 2, we added little wings to the rods so they don't fall the wrong way. And when you receive the keyboard, the side legs have stickers that indicate that you need to deploy them. It's those little things that make a design feel polished. So when you tent or tilt your keyboard, you do it with the pleasure that only an over-engineered design provides. What do you think? Did we overdo it? Or how would you improve it? Let us know in the comments below. Oh, and don't forget to subscribe if you want to watch more content like this. Until the next one!